If only Griffin had managed to wake up in good time, all might have been well. As it was, he did not wake up until the assistants were already arriving next morning. All the sales boys and sales girls had started arriving. When he saw a couple of them approaching, he panicked and began to run. They naturally ran after him. In the end, he was able to escape only by quickly taking off his newly found clothes. So once more, he found himself invisible but naked in the chill, very icy cold January air. This time he decided to try the stock of a theatrical company, a company that put up plays and dramas here and there in the hope of finding not only clothes but also something that would hide the empty space above his shoulders. Obviously, he was looking for a head, okay? Shivering with cold, he hurried to Drury Lane, the center of the theater world. He soon found a suitable shop. He made his way invisible upstairs and came out a little later wearing bandages around his forehead, dark glasses, false nose, big bushy side whiskers, and a large hat. To escape without being seen, he cruelly attacked the shopkeeper from behind, after which he robbed him of all the money he could find. Eager to get away from crowded London, he took a train to the village of Iping, where he booked two rooms at the local inn, a small hotel or a motel. The event of a stranger at an inn in winter was in any case an unusual event. It rarely happened that a stranger will come in winter. A stranger of such uncommon, such unusual appearance set all tongues wagging. Everyone started talking and gossiping about this stranger. Mrs. Hall, the landlord's wife, made every effort to be friendly. But Griffin had no desire to talk and told her, "My reason for coming to Iping is a desire for solitude, for loneliness. I want to be alone. I do not wish to be disturbed in my work. Besides, an accident has affected my face." Satisfied that her guest was an eccentric scientist. Eccentricity is when a person is so brilliant, so intelligent, he becomes slightly crazy. They are wise and intelligent in very sophisticated and wise things. But in simple things, they are crazy, they're almost mad. So that's called eccentricity. And she thought that this fellow was an eccentric scientist. And in view of the fact that he had paid her in advance, Mrs. Hall was prepared to excuse his strange habits and irritable temper. But the stolen money did not last long. And presently, Griffin had to admit that he had no more ready cash. No more ready cash. No money with him at present. Sometimes we use the word liquid cash. He pretended, however, that he was expecting a check to arrive at any moment. Shortly afterwards, a curious episode occurred. A strange incident happened. Very early in the morning, a clergyman, a religious person, a priest, and his wife were awakened by noises in the study. Study is a room where the man will usually do his work. Creeping downstairs, they heard the chink of money being taken from the clergyman's desk. Without making any noise and with a poker grasped firmly in his hand, the clergyman flung open the door. A poker is an iron rod with which you poke the coals to make the fire burn brighter. Surrender! Then, to his amazement, he realized that the room appeared to be empty. He and his wife looked under the desk and behind the curtains and even up the chimney. There wasn't a sign of anybody, yet the desk had been opened and the housekeeping money was missing. In every home, as usual, was some amount of money to be lying in an open, or we can call it a secret place, but only the people of the house will know where that money is. So that is money to buy vegetables, to buy milk, to pay for the gas, to pay the postman, for any small unexpected reasons that money is available. That is housekeeping money. Extraordinary affair, the clergyman kept saying for the rest of the day. But it was not as extraordinary as the behavior of Mrs. Hall's furniture a little later that morning.